I will also speak of your
testimonies before kings, and shall not be put to shame.
So began the question.
Read by Dr. Christian Beyer before Emperor Charles V at the Imperial Diet in the city of
Augsburg on this date, the 25th of June, the year of our Lord, 1530. Now, even though it had just been written, this confession in and of itself was something very old. It was a confession of the teaching of Holy Scripture and a correction of the abuses that had corrupted the church. As it was then, so still it remains, a confession of the true, Orthodox, Catholic, Christian faith. Now, having been written by Philip Melanchthon, it was yet signed and presented by the princes and the electors and the churches throughout the lands of Germany. They subscribed to it, and they made it their own. And almost a year ago, when I was ordained and installed as your pastor, I was asked, do you confess the unaltered Augsburg Confession to be a true exposition of Holy Scripture and a correct exhibition of the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church? And do you confess that the other confessions and creeds in the Book of Concord are also in agreement with this one scriptural faith? My response was then, and still remains, yes, I make these confessions my own because they are in accord with the Word of God. Make these confessions my own. And so grace has also made it her own. In the third article of her Constitution, our church pledges that as a correct presentation and true exposition of the doctrines of Holy Scripture, this congregation receives all the confessional books of the Lutheran Church contained in the Book of Concord. Hence, no doctrine shall be taught or tolerated in this congregation, which is at variance with these confessional books. That is the nature of confession. It must be made your own. As the great 20th century theologian Herman Sasse said, a confession cannot remain a real confession if it is only inherited. It must be confessed. We can only confess if we are deeply convinced that it is the true interpretation of Scripture. We are Lutherans, not for the sake of denominational loyalty, but in faithfulness to the truth of the gospel of Christ Jesus. We are Lutherans because we are Christians. Christians in the fullest and most faithful sense of the name. As the sixth vice president of our synod, Reverend Christopher Esgid, declared, in this day when contending for doctrine is highly unpopular, we continue to assert the narrow way of the Lutheran confessions, not to prove we are right, better, or smarter, but in the humble acknowledgement that only the pure word of God can give us true comfort and sustain the church against her enemies. So hear and take to heart as I read for you the affirmative statements of the Augsburg Confession on this, the 487th anniversary of the presentation of the Augsburg Confession. The first article, God. Our churches teach with common consent that the decree of the Council of Nicaea about the unity of the divine essence and the three persons is true. It is to be believed without any doubt. God is one divine essence who is eternal, without a body, without parts, of infinite power, wisdom, and goodness. He is the maker and preserver of all things, visible and invisible. Yet there are three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. These three persons are of the same essence and power. Our churches use the term person as the fathers have used it. We use it to signify not a part or quality in another, but that which subsists in itself. The second article, original sin. Our churches teach that since the fall of Adam, all who are naturally born are born with sin. That is, without the fear of God, without trust in God, and with the inclination to sin, called concupiscence. Concupiscence is a disease and original vice that is truly sin. It damns and brings eternal death on those who are not born anew through baptism and the Holy Spirit. Article 3, the Son of God. Our churches teach that the Word, that is, the Son of God, assumed the human nature in the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary. So there are two natures, the divine and the human, inseparably joined in one person. There is one Christ, true God and true man, who was born of the Virgin Mary, truly suffered, was crucified, died, and was buried. He did this to reconcile the Father to us and to be a sacrifice, not only for original guilt, but also for all actual sins of mankind. He descended into hell and truly rose again on the third day. Afterward, he ascended into heaven to sit at the right hand of the Father. There he forever reigns and has dominion over all creatures. He sanctifies those who believe in him by sending the Holy Spirit into their hearts to rule, comfort, and make them alive. He defends them against the devil and the power of sin. The same Christ will openly come again to judge the living and the dead, and so forth, according to the Apostles' Creed. Article 4, Justification. Our churches teach that people cannot be justified before God by their own strength, merit, or works. People are freely justified for Christ's sake through faith, when they believe that they are received into favor and that their sins are forgiven for Christ's sake. By death, Christ made satisfaction for our sins. God counts this faith for righteousness in his sight. Article 5, the ministry. So that we may obtain this faith, the ministry of teaching the gospel and administering the sacraments was instituted. Through the word and sacraments, as through instruments, the Holy Spirit is given. He works faith when and where in those who hear the good news that God justifies those who believe that they are received into grace for Christ's sake. This happens not through our own merits, but for Christ's sake. Article 6, New Obedience. Our churches teach that this faith is bound to bring forth good works. It is necessary to do good works commanded by God's will. We should not rely on those works to merit justification before God. The forgiveness of sins and justification is through faith. The voice of Christ testifies, so also you, when you have done all that you were commanded, say, we are unworthy servants. We have only done what was our duty. Ambrose says, it is ordained of God that he who believes in Christ is saved, freely receiving forgiveness of sins, without works, through faith alone. Article 7, the Church. Our churches teach that one holy church is to remain forever. The church is the congregation of saints in which the gospel is purely taught and the sacraments are correctly administered. For the true unity of the church, it is enough to agree about the doctrine of the gospel and the administration of the sacraments. It is not necessary that human traditions, that is, rites or ceremonies instituted by men, should be the same everywhere. As St. Paul says, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. Article 8, what the church is. Strictly speaking, the church is the congregation of saints and true believers. However, because many hypocrites and evil persons are mingled within them in this life, it is lawful to use sacraments administered by evil men, according to the same Christ. The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Both the sacraments and the word are effective because of Christ's institution and command, even if they are administered by evil men. Article 9, Baptism. Concerning baptism, our churches teach that baptism is necessary for salvation, and that God's grace is offered through baptism. They teach that children are to be baptized. Being offered to God through baptism, they are received into God's grace. Article 10, the Lord's Supper. Our churches teach that the body and blood of Christ are truly present and distributed to those who eat the Lord's Supper. Article 11, Confession. Our churches teach that private absolution should be retained in the churches, although listing all sins is not necessary for confession. For according to the psalm, it is impossible. Who can discern his errors? Article 12, Repentance. Our churches teach that there is forgiveness of sins for those who have fallen after baptism whenever they are converted. The church ought to impart absolution to those who return to repentance. Now, strictly speaking, repentance consists of two parts. One part is contrition, that is, terrors, striking the conscience through the knowledge of sin. The other part is faith, which is born of the gospel or the absolution, and believes that for Christ's sake sins are forgiven. It comforts the conscience and delivers it from terror. Then good works are bound to follow, which are the fruit of repentance. Article 13, the use of the sacraments. Our churches teach that the sacraments were ordained not only to be marks of perfection among men, but even more, to be signs and testimonies of God's will toward us. They were instituted to awaken and confirm faith in those who use them. Therefore, we must use the sacraments in such a way that faith, which believes the promises offered and set forth through the sacraments, is increased. Article 14, Order in the Church. Our churches teach that no one should publicly teach in the church or administer the sacraments without a rightly ordered call. Article 15, Church Ceremonies. Our churches teach that ceremonies ought to be offered that may be observed without sin. Also, ceremonies and other practices that are profitable for tranquility and good order in the church, in particular holy days, festivals, and the like, ought to be observed. Article 16, Civil Government. Our churches teach that lawful civil regulations are good works of God. They teach that it is right for Christians to hold political office, to serve as judges, to judge matters by imperial laws and other existing laws, to impose just punishments, to engage in just wars, to serve as soldiers, to make legal contracts, to hold property, to take oaths when required by the magistrates, for a man to marry a wife or a woman to be given in marriage. Article 17, Christ's return for judgment. Our churches teach that at the end of the world, Christ will appear for judgment and will raise all the dead. He will give the godly and elect eternal life and everlasting joys, but he will condemn ungodly people and the devils to be tormented without end. Article 18, Free Will. Our churches teach that a person's will has some freedom to choose civil righteousness and to do things subject to reason. It has no power without the Holy Spirit to work the righteousness of God, that is, spiritual righteousness. For the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. This righteousness is worked in the heart when the Holy Spirit is received through the Word. Article 19, the cause of sin. Our churches teach that although God creates and preserves nature, the cause of sin is located in the will of the wicked, that is the devil and ungodly people. Without God's help, this will turns itself away from God, as Christ says. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character. Article 20, Good Works. Our teachers teach the churches about faith in this way. First, they teach that our works cannot reconcile God to us or merit forgiveness of sins, grace, and justification. We obtain reconciliation only by faith when we believe that we are received into favor for Christ's sake. He alone has been set forth as the mediator and atoning sacrifice in order that the Father may be reconciled through him. Therefore, whoever believes that he merits grace by works despises the merit and grace of Christ. In so doing, he is seeking the way to God without Christ, by human strength, although Christ himself said, I am the way and the truth and the life. This doctrine about faith is presented everywhere by Paul. By grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. If anyone wants to be tricky and say that we have invented a new interpretation of Paul, this entire matter is supported by the testimony of the fathers. Augustine defends grace and the righteousness of faith in many volumes against the merits of work. Ambrose, in his book, The Calling of the Gentiles, and elsewhere, teaches the same thing. In The Calling of the Gentiles, he says, redemption by Christ's blood would be worth very little, and God's mercy would not surpass man's works if justification, which is accomplished through grace, were due to prior merits. So justification would not be the free gift from a donor, but the reward due a laborer. Spiritually inexperienced people despise this teaching. However, God-fearing and anxious consciences find the experience that it brings the greatest consolation. Consciences cannot be at rest through any works, but only by faith, when they take the sure ground that for Christ's sake they have a gracious God. As Paul teaches, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God. This whole doctrine must be related to the conflict of terrified consciences. It cannot be understood apart from that conflict. Therefore, inexperienced and irreverent people have poor judgment in this matter, because they dream that Christian righteousness is nothing but civil and philosophical righteousness. Furthermore, we teach that it is necessary to do good works. This does not mean that we merit grace by doing good works, but because it is God's will. It is only by faith and nothing else that forgiveness of sins is apprehended. The Holy Spirit is received through faith. Hearts are renewed and given new affection. Then they are able to bring forth good works. Ambrose says, faith is the mother of a good will and doing what is right. Without the Holy Spirit, people are full of ungodly desires. They are too weak to do works that are good in God's sight. Besides, they are in the power of the devil, who pushes human beings into various sins, ungodly opinions, and open crimes. Article 21. Worship of the saints. Our churches teach that the history of the saints may be set forth before us so that we may follow the example of their faith and good works according to our calling. For example, the emperor may follow the example of David in making war to drive away the Turk from his country, for both are kings. But the scriptures do not teach that we are to call the saints or to ask the saints for help. Scripture sets before us the one Christ as the mediator, atoning sacrifice, high priest, and intercessor. He is to be prayed to. He has promised that he will hear our prayer. This is the worship that he approves above all other worship, that he may be called upon in all afflictions. If anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father. The summary statement. This, then, is merely a complete summary of our teachings. As can be seen, there is nothing that varies from Scripture or from the Church Universal or from the Church of Rome as known from its writers. Since this is the case, those who insist that our teachers are to be regarded as heretics are judging harshly. and the conclusion. We have mentioned only those things we thought it was necessary to talk about, so that it would be understood that in doctrine and ceremonies we have received nothing contrary to Scripture or the Church universal. It is clear that we have been very careful to make sure no new godly, ungodly doctrine creeps into our churches. We present these articles in accordance with your Imperial Majesty's edict, in order to show our confession and let people see a summary of our teacher's doctrine. It may not have been the most exciting sermon, but it is an important confession. The nature and character of what we believe, teach, and confess, and what we believe, teach, and confess as Christians and as individuals in our neighborhood and in the world. And we do so so that people may see the summary of what we hold. They may hear the gospel, but they may come to saving faith. For faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so let us this day give thanks for the confessors at Augsburg, who heard the word and were not ashamed to speak it before kings. And let us then again make this confession our own. And by the grace of God, resolved to suffer all, even death, rather than fall away from it. May the peace of God which